Welcome to Shh the Talk Show Season 3. If you believe in the conversations we're trying to create here, please subscribe to our channels as that will help us get more reach. If you watch the YouTube pre-roll ads before this episode in completion, that also helps us to make a little bit of money that help us to go a long way. Our show is now available in 3 languages, so you can click on your subtitle of choice, whether it's Sinhala, Tamil or English. You can follow this conversation wherever you are in Sri Lanka. And we also welcome you to continue these taboo conversations with us on our social media, which is Facebook, Instagram and Twitter, and also our blog posts coming out and our articles in the Sunday morning newspaper. Enjoy the show. Today's conversation is happening in this wonderful, free and casual vibe of Home Tree. Home Tree is a co-working space and it's in Bambalapitiya. We're so grateful that they've come on board and been our location sponsor today. You can come and check out the space, especially to all the single girls out there, because that's what this show is about. If you are trying to build yourself a career, if you're a young entrepreneur working on your own, needing a space away from home, to come and connect, to network, to meet like-minded people and to give yourself space to think and succeed, try Home Tree. The sound of the aircrafts and stuff that you might hear, they actually might be the aunties, society's aunties just hovering around and listening to this conversation today. Because I want to rant, I'm triggered today, because I think there's an issue that a lot of women face, especially in this part of the world, and that is the choice to be single, right? And for some reason, Sri Lankan society just cannot compute or process the fact that a woman can have an independent wish to not have a husband and child according to her body clock or according to society's clock. And so I wanted to talk about that. And you might think that this is a very Colombo first world problem, but I don't think it is. I think a lot of girls around our country are pressured into following certain life milestones because they feel like that's how it should be done. That is what is expected of their, from their families and friends and all that. And here I am at 42 years old, still fighting off this stigma of being single by choice. Childless by choice, and somehow everybody has something to say about it. And I'm so grateful to these two ladies. We have Lilanka and Nishani who have joined us. And there, I told you, helicopter aunties.
Like, you're both single right now.
Yes.
Right? Single by choice.
By choice. Yes, by choice.
And are you in a relationship?
No.
Not at the moment.
No, okay. Not that we are averse to it. I'm not averse to a relationship, but I don't believe in being in a relationship because that's a tick box against a woman's name or anyone's name for that matter. So I'd prefer to be single versus being in something for the sake of it. So that's why it's a choice to be single versus just being, oh, it's time for you to find somebody, you know, better, like, you know, get married or
every function you go to and you think these things will stop after a while, that they'll think you're over the hill and now let it go, but they just don't, right?
No, it just never stops. It's just that where you are like right now in life, you know what you want for yourself, and it's much more harder when you know what you want to look for, look for that. So you make the choice to wait until you find what you really want. So, and that's a choice, personal choice. So it's however long it takes, you know, you remain in that position, and that's fine.
And if you don't find anybody, it's fine to live and die alone. Exactly. It's really not an issue. And the thing is, actually, both of us have seen a lot of less than desirable relationships. Let's put it that way. Okay. Things.
I have been in less than desirable relationships.
Yeah. Right? Okay. So seeing that, I think we are like, we keep saying we are so glad we are not married. We are so glad we are not in something for the sake of it. Yeah. Like we said, we are not, I mean, we are not averse to it. There are some really good marriages, but unfortunately there are very few. And relationships, you see all these red flags waving around and this toxicity, like a banner running everywhere, and everybody's like, oh no, but I can't, you know, ever fathom being alone. And you're just like, are you kidding me? Like, yeah. I would rather be alone at home with myself, where I have control over me and it's my choice to be happy or not. Right? And this whole notion that you need someone else to be fulfilled and all is bullshit. Ask any psychologist who's worth their salt, and they'll tell you, you find happiness within yourself. Whoever else you find, you build something new together. And that's great if you can do that. If you don't, it's okay. It's not that there's this missing part of me, you know, my rib that went to some man is like lurking in the, you know, realms of Sri Lanka or wherever in the world, and I must go with a fishing rod and look for this rib, and you're like, darling, no, sorry. I'm happy the way I am.
But you wouldn't put it past them, you know, to go with that fishing rod on your behalf and start.
But fishing rod, it'll be a fishing net.
So right now, I mentioned earlier, it's not that I'm not open to relationships. I believe actually having someone to actually share your life with, share what you have already built for yourself with, whether it's in a relationship or in a marriage, is actually a wonderful thing. It's a good thing. If you make the right choices, you make the good choices. But where I am right now, I feel I actually need to look for what I want. Yeah. And I'm just not ready to settle for whatever is out there.
Yeah.
Just because I need to, you know, tick a box, or just to save face, or just to, you know, get society or my parents or my family or my friends to leave me alone from the question, are you seeing anyone? Why aren't you seeing anyone yet? You haven't met anyone yet.
The whole thing is, when you're a little girl, they force this idea or they condition this idea of someday you will get married
and the whole wedding, it's going to be all magical. Disney didn't do us any favors in that, it's not magical, it's hard work, it's reality.
And I've seen, right, especially these Kalambo families and all that, when you have the little boys and the little girls playing, then the mothers are plotting.
Yes,
like,
of
those
course.
Children are about 5 years old.
Yes. They have
nice,
no idea.
Nice, no, if they grow up together and end up
married. House
then seat. They put those things, they make you sort of love the whole idea of the fluffy wedding and all of that. Little girls grow up, of course, dreaming of the knight on his shining steed, which I blame pop culture
for.
Yes,
it is pop culture.
Because what we teach little girls is also that whole thing of the knight on the white steed.
Overly romanticizing it, overly, I think, yeah, overly fantasized.
Saving your life. And because you cannot make a life of. No. Your own, not all princesses.
And you can't save yourself.
Not all princesses.
Sticky situations,
saving.
A man needs to come. Exactly. Right, and go like, yeah, baby, let me save you. And you're just like.
I think where it comes from is that from smaller days, girls are being conditioned. Your mind is being conditioned that you have to grow up to, you know, to find a partner. Not to share, but to be a dependent. Ultimately, you become a dependent. So I think that conditioning is very unfair. And that's where most girls or women will, you know, tend to make wrong decisions when it comes to, you know, getting into relationships and settling for whatever is out there just to tick that box.
Yeah, because now even sort of, okay, I would like to say that I feel lucky that I have had less pressure to be forced into something that I don't want. But I know a lot of my friends have been in this situation where even in school, the conversations were all around, okay, who's the first to have a boyfriend? Because it's like an achievement.
And a competition.
Right? To say, I have a boyfriend. Nothing to do with a boy.
Yeah.
Do you like the boy or not? To be able to tell everybody, I have now come to this phase. Then it's a case of everywhere you go, aunties, if it's not, when are you doing your exams and what are you studying? The next question is, when are you getting married? The minute that is fixed, right? You come out of school, honda kollekko hoya garune. And it makes me sad when I listen to young girls also. You're asking them about their dreams and ambitions and they're like, mehem me meka paadam karanawa, me subject ekak mama paadam karanawa, eunata 24 vithara me marry karannone, wedding ekak gannone.
And it's got a husband do not permission, it's got a mama padang karanang, and you're like,
why wedding make a gandor? And then that happens, right? Yeah. The minute you hit 19, they're coming after you every family function. It's like, so are you seeing anyone?
Oh,
here's so and so son.
Yes.
Why don't you go and dance? Go and have a dance.
Oh my god. Oh, even shall I introduce someone to you? Shall I find someone for you? And you're like, no, please don't. Look at your marriage. It's a mess. No, thank you, auntie. I'm fine on my own. Scuttle away to the other end of the hall and hope you never see that back again. Oh, my God. Oh, but now I'm like a little bit more, like, egg roll, let's put it that way, because I'm sick of this. So I'm like, no, auntie, the problem. So why haven't you found anyone? My darling, now you're this age, blah, blah, now you've done everything. So I'm like, no, auntie, if you all had bothered bringing up your sons a bit better, would like, you know, where they can handle a woman like me and not be threatened by it, then maybe I'd be married. Then, oh, shit, my ratranputa, she da-dang. And I'm like, yeah, that's right. So I'm a bitch now, sorry. But no, it's but the thing is, that is actually one of the reasons why a lot of independent women don't want to be married in the conventional sense, is because there is this notion that marriage includes some kind of dependency, as you said. Yeah, exactly. And it's like a trap. I think the word wedlock is a very good term. You're literally locked in there, because then it's like, oh, I can't do this because I need my husband's permission. And, you know, then it's like, oh, you know, I don't like my wife to work. I like her to be at home doing this. And it's like, it's not about what she wants and what you want and let's work together something out. It's more like, this is how my parents did it. This is what I've been conditioned to do. And you better follow it.
And various obligations which society feels that women should take on. It's rather than a partnership, it's like a load of responsibilities and duties on a woman.
Yeah.
Which should be, not be the case. It's a 50-50 partnership. Both have to work together to, you know, make it.
And shared responsibilities.
Shared responsibilities.
I mean, are so great. Like, when you see people that really have relationships that work that way, it's really good. Because, you know, it's not, you know, neither is feeling, you know, insecure or feeling like, oh, I have to deal with everything. So it's like you give, I mean, obviously it's not going to be 50-50 cut across. I mean,
you give and take
and then you interact and then you decide and you say, listen, you're good. And so there may be households where the husband is a really good cook and the wife may be really horrid at cooking. She'll be like, listen, it's your forte, you do it. I'll help. Yeah, exactly. I'll bring the groceries or cut the vegetables. And that's great when it works out. But then if you have this idea in the head and you're like, a man only handles these things
man
in the house.
Only provides
and the woman handles
the
this.
The children are the woman's responsibility. The kitchen is
the
woman's
place. Yeah, your baby. And then it's like so much pressure. It's even pressure for a guy, right? If he's supposed to be the only financial provider for his family and say he's under pressure at work and maybe he doesn't want to do this job. And it's not fair, but it's like this whole thing of, you're the provider and if you're not, you're not a man and all this. So, I mean, patriarchy sucks. Patriarchy is actually really, I would say, crippling for men and women. It's just that people don't see it that way.
Yeah.
They seem to think it's like a feminist fun topic, like, oh, the feminazis are on their aunt again. No, man no. haters.
So now when you say you're single, especially, okay, now in your 20s, they want to get you married off or they think you should. And if you haven't gotten, they're like, do you have a boyfriend? If you don't, it's almost like they take it upon themselves to help you.
Charity, social service to find us boyfriend.
I don't know why they can't conceive the fact that maybe you don't want the help, maybe you're not in that desperate position. And I have to give this disclaimer. Of course, we are ranting today because we have personal views on this. But by no means are we being dismissive of girls who do make the choice to get married,
who do fall
in love, who do have
the important word there is choice.
It's choice. Yes,
it's
exactly.
choice. It's wonderful, but this is about, we're talking about women who don't make that choice, who have a different choice. And the fact that somehow that makes us either less or makes us psycho or makes us gay.
Lesbian. So then it's like a question mark. Is she lesbian?
And Lila, you know, right? Just being in theater, being in the arts,
that's the question I have got. Oh, you're like bisexual, don't know what's happening.
Must be lesbian.
And you're just like, it's really nobody's business. Yeah. Your gender or sexual orientation or whatever is a personal thing relevant to that person. And it's like, but you know, it's funny because I had an aunt who was single and she was considered very smart, intelligent and all that. So everybody's like, why isn't she married? She never got married. I mean, she lived and died single all her life. And I remember my grandmother never gave up, of course. Yeah. Like, why can't this child find somebody and get married? Even
my
if she was 60. And also I remember like my aunt saying, how a relative once asked her, are you a lesbian? And she's like, the hell did that come
where
from?
Where did that assumption
it's
come
like
from?
Suddenly
what's the basis for that
yeah.
assumption, right?
And mind you, these are educated people. They are not in some boondock in some cave somewhere. These are Colombo society, educated, exposed to the world, traveled people who still have these very archaic ideas. And she's like, just because I'm not married doesn't mean I'm a lesbian, dude. Like, and anyway, even if it was, none of your business. But still, like, so these are these, and the whole thing of, like you said, you're less. is something that's really, so that this ane pau attitude. So actually we were discussing how, you know, like ane pau ne api yata horasan kiyamu yata honda kollek oya, let's pray
for her.
Novenas and bows and all
aunt
that.
Aunt is volunteer to pray for you because you are single and you're like, I think you and your children need prayers
more than me.
I've actually had a friend's mother who doesn't know me very well also, a former colleague's mother, who offered to do a bodhi puja.
Because we call it, and you're just like, no, there are other things we're doing. Bar is what you really want to be doing.
Pressing issues. So many other pressing issues in the world. Yeah, exactly. We're not unhappy. I used to get offended. I used to get upset about it many, many years ago about, you know, people coming and asking, and actually they pity you and they ask you why not, and you know, I'll pray again, you know, I have so many aunties who pray and worship and all that, and I used to get offended, but as you grow older you realize, look, the more secure you become within yourself, you realize that you pity them back because that's all they know. All they know in their life is to basically grow up and get married and have children and, you know, repeat that cycle. They don't know anything beyond, there is no other happiness. They don't know any other happiness beyond that. Yeah. So it's, I've responded very lightly. I think I'd make a joke, I'd laugh about it. Yes, please find me someone. I would joke about it, and it just goes over my head. It doesn't affect me anymore.
If a woman doesn't have that man to take care of, because whatever said and done, the infrastructure in the country is also not female friendly, right?
No,
we don't have equality. We don't. That patriarchal system is so there that there is a very real challenge to single women at whatever age to make it on their own, to survive on their own. Whether it's you know, even in the workplace, the chances of harassment, the chances of, if you want to live alone, my God, just renting a place for yourself comes
the
with
volley of questions that you would answer when you go to rent
people
a house.
People are not
on
comfortable renting out a house. Yeah. single woman thinking
she's fast, she's loose,
she's a wanton woman.
Yeah, exactly. Loose creature.
There'll be parties, there'll be people coming
there'll
over,
there'll be a man going visiting good. And it might like, be a poor platonic friend or brother even, but that's like a man
that she's not getting married to.
Yeah, and then it's like this. No, because I know, like you mentioned, this renting thing. They say, and they give rules, you can't have guests after 9 o'clock. And like, these people are a little cuckoo. I'm like, darling, if anyone wants to have sex, they're having sex, regardless of your curfews, regardless of your rules. The most confined ones are having better sex than those of us out there who are so out open.
I don't think that's inspiring any confidence in anyone who's watching this. What I'm saying is, okay, so there are these real systematic issues, right, for single women. So then you have concerned parents and family who say, okay, so for her status, for her respectability, for her stability, financial stability, or
and to have
whatever,
someone to take care of you when you're older.
Someone has
future.
To be there. She needs that backup. Parents are very scared, okay, if we die, who's there to look after
is the word.
Valid. Yeah. As a parent, you'll always fear, no? I don't know why they don't fear that for the son, because they always seem to think the son can manage, but the daughter can't, right?
That's also because of the whole idea that a woman needs, is not independent on her own.
Yeah.
That whole, the thinking that a woman can take care of herself is not
accepted general
view.
Also,
in this
it's much more difficult, I would say, for a woman to take care of herself in that sort of space of everybody second guessing her and not giving her a chance to show. Now, would you say that, okay, so we know there is this real challenge, and so then therefore they think the older you get, right, if you're still not, if you don't have a partner, the older you get, you're losing out your chance. Because the men are sort of, my mother used to say, they are not going to wait in line.
Yeah. And the fish in the sea are
dwindling.
The good
ones are being
taken.
And you have like a blobfish somewhere.
Yeah. And then you have to settle for anything.
Yeah.
But then they also become that. They are like, better for you to marry this person now
than
waiting a little longer. There'll be no one. And then I'll be dead and gone. And you're just like,
it's okay to have no one. That's fine.
It's fine.
No, but I think a lot of women also tend to then start getting worried, like, where, because that's all you know and that's all you're being told. Also, I feel like a lot of single women, a lot of independent girls who start out young and like strong in their independence can get worried for themselves and can then compromise
Yeah, because it's
just to feed.
That is also all because of what society feeds you with, the ideas and the stress and the pressure that the society feeds you with. Even the insecurities a single woman can actually develop within herself is all because of what the society puts into their head. What single women or girls out there don't understand is that you know, the idea of a single independent woman or singlehood among women is far different to the stereotype spinster and old maid of the past. We are much more independent, educationally attained, accomplished,
and we are
connected,
financially independent,
we are connected, we are exposed to society, to technology, we are able, much more capable. So why do you need to question a woman's ability to take care of herself? She's got everything going on for herself. If that is all in place, there is really no reason to feel unable or to, you know, push her to make choices that she doesn't want to take, right?
No, and also what you, this whole unable thing, if you look at, like you said, nobody worries about the men. So you have this happy bachelor boy, sworn bachelor. He's a sworn bachelor. And the thing is...
But he's cool.
But he's cool.
Uncle is not married. Uncle is cool.
Because he's having a good time, But also uncle what might have issues like... He might be addicted to alcohol, he might have drug issues, but nobody's saying anepao to him.
He can't cook for himself, he can't maintain his own house.
He's eating from out cooked every day,
and
all that
can't clean for himself.
Bachelor, happy, lucky bugger machang, unlike us fellows stuck with our wives at home and that kind of talk. And then the woman who's happy and who doesn't
who's financially independent, like funding her own life, who's cooking for herself, who's cleaning you know, herself, who's maintaining a house, running everything on her own, is suddenly
anepao. And you're like...
The power's gone to the wrong place.
Send that anepao to that said scene. He actually might need some help. But the conditioning is such that men will somehow survive. And men, that's another reason there's so much even sexual abuse when you take for little boys, because everybody assumes a little boy is a man. A little man
can deal.
And even if someone comes and touches, it's okay. I mean, they'll be okay. Whereas the little girl is like...
Precious little
mala. Bear must let her into a world of thorns, but that's okay, we'll bring her up like the mala. So this whole thing of anepao for the single spinster woman, and you'll end up like these old, and these old feminist ideas, that's another thing. You're full of
wrong
this feminism.
Wrong notion of feminism.
So she hates men, and you're like, no, I don't hate men, dude, please don't get that. You can be a man and be a feminist. Just believe in equality.
Also, you can be single and date without needing to get married. Now I want to talk about that casual dating, because obviously when you have decided that you want to be single, you want to discover yourself, you don't want to get into the entrapment of a relationship yet. That's your choice. But at the same time, that doesn't mean you necessarily want to hide in your bathroom for the rest of your life, right? You obviously want to use your singlehood to be able to meet people, to network, to develop relationships. If you like, they can be sexual. If you don't like, they can be simply developing friendships with the other sex. It is possible.
And it should be. It's possible, it should be, and it's healthy that you do.
But shocking though, when you see a single woman of a certain age with a single man of a certain age, if they go out for a coffee together and they could be completely platonic friends or getting to know each other, the immediate assumption is, those two.
They're doing it. And you're just like, no, and the thing is, even if they are,
so what?
If you're not getting some, please get some. You know, it's really healthy, scientifically proven, very good for skin and all, like general serotonin and all those things blowing out of your head. But this depravity, there is a level of sexual depravity in our society. Of course, you see it in the buses. I mean, only need to put a woman even in a sack. If you put her in the bus, there'll be some fellow groping her thigh and trying to jack gahanna and all that. But
we did a show on that.
Oh yes, I saw that. So the problem is with that level of sexual depravity, it is there in the women too. Like, though they are not saying it, so their thing is like, oh, only when you're married can one have sex, and that. And a good sexual relationship is important for a healthy marriage or any relationship. So the whole thing is that this license to have sex is this notion. So that's, I think, another reason why people are so scared of single women. Now she'll be, you know, somebody will have their way with her before she's married off.
Then this thing about that casual relationships and sexual relationships and all that, right? Now,
whilst then what about the single woman? Like I said, now I've been raised Catholic. I've been raised with this expectation of the kind of image that you project of yourself and the kind of image you project of your family
and the Catholic respectability.
Yes. Everybody knows who you are, everybody knows whose child you are and whose grandchild you are, and that weight of that expectation is. Therefore, everyone I interact with and how I interact publicly, I have to be super conscious. And I have to tell you, that's a huge mental pressure on me. Right? That even if I want to date someone, the first go-to fear is, what will my parents say? What will my mother say? I hope, and at 42, if I go out for a drink with someone, I'm looking around, I'm scanning the room to make sure there isn't anyone who knows me, simply because I don't want it going back to my family saying, okay, she met someone for a drink. Just a drink. But that in family circles also, that drink can become this massive.
No, and it's a bar, no, a drink, right. You didn't meet for communion.
No, so always in Colombo, the way this country works is always within 5 minutes, some auntie or uncle is calling, who are you with?
Oh my God.
Like, we heard you, so and so, you were with.
Are you serious?
You know, there are questions.
Yeah, I'm lucky I don't get that. Yeah.
What do you do? Okay, so that's why I want to ask the two of you, okay, when you date, and if you're dating, if you're meeting people casually, how do you manage that?
Personally, luckily for me, it hasn't been so bad. Like, where, you know, if I'm meeting people that my parents would get to know, I don't know, rumors around it or etc. Even if there was, see, it's again, when you, I think by the time that you make that conscious decision to be single, either by choice, voluntarily, or by circumstance, I think it's a responsibility that we girls also should take it into our heads about how much are we going to affect other people's how much are we going to allow other people's opinions to affect us, right? Yeah. If I am to stand up for myself and say, look, I'm going to remain single until I find something that really, you know, works for me, until then I'm going to meet whoever is out there and see what's out there, you know, enjoy companionship, etc., which is nothing wrong. I have to stand up for myself and say that, look, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what other people say. You cannot be pleasing other people. You cannot be making everybody else happy if you want to live your life. So it's a mentality that it's hard, it's difficult, it's really tough, but it's a part of growth.
Yeah,
it's part of growth as a woman, right? If you actually want to call yourself an independent woman and you make this choice for yourself, that is a place of mind, a mindset that you need to reach.
Because I just feel like families also can become such bullies.
Absolutely,
right?
Absolutely. Like, that's the first. See, ideally, the biggest challenge for single women is their immediate support system. Your family is meant to be your immediate support system, right?
Yeah.
They are supposed to stand by you and support your decisions, whatever you do in life. But unfortunately, that becomes your that becomes the very same entity that you need to fight against.
Mm.
Unfortunately, right? That's just, maybe it's a Sri Lankan thing, it's a cultural thing, but which shouldn't be the case.
Yeah.
So, at the end of the day, I guess it's how much we tell ourselves that. You know, how much we teach ourselves how to deal with it.
Yeah, no, because, like she said, I'm very lucky. My parents are very, how should I put it, they're very easygoing.
Progressive.
I would say that because actually my parents are divorced, but they never, like, shackled me growing up. Even I never had these crazy curfews or anything. And as a result, I never abused their trust. And I remember my mother once asked, do you want me to look for anyone for you? I said, please don't. And she's like, okay, as long as you're happy. And that's what she tells other nosy parkers also. So I've heard her telling these aunties, like, oh, your daughter's not married. And Ami's like, yeah, no, she's happy the way she is. And Tati once asked, and I said, listen, Tati, assholes out there. You want me to end up with an asshole? And Tati's like, no. And my father's like, kill all the assholes. But he never, like, even with my brother and me, both of them have always taken a step back. And I'm utterly grateful because they have said, as long as you're happy being who you are and you're happy with yourself, then we are not going to force anything on you.
Mm-hmm.
But having said that, one thing I do know is I keep asking, listen, what if you never want to get married, but you want to have a relationship with somebody? You want to meet that person. You want to even have sex with that person, because obviously a relationship will progress to that. And I think we need to stop judging people for doing that, because they are not, it's not like they're cheating on a partner or they're hurting someone else. They're two independent people getting together. And I think at some point you have to be pig-headed enough to just to tell people, listen, I'm here in one capacity. You're not here judging me on who I'm dating and what I'm doing behind closed doors.
Absolutely.
It's none of your business, number one. I think we need to learn to say that very diplomatically, but at the same time, very forcefully, so that people understand what their boundaries are. And if you take it even overseas, where people have things called civil partnerships, even in countries like Australia, you know, they're not legally married, they just live together.
But that is completely not possible here.
No, no, my God, by morality, you're forgetting the chastity belt is on here, man. It's not in Bridgerton, it's here in Sri Lanka. Like, the aunties are still wearing the chastity belt, and you're just like, oh my God, take it off! It's Victorian, it's not even Sri Lankan Sanskrit here.
Yeah.
Like, you know, I mean, if you look at Sri Lankan culture, technically, we didn't have a concept of marriage before the Portuguese. The word casada comes from casados, which is a Spanish Latin origin word. So before that, everyone just shacked up together.
Just, yeah, exactly.
It's like, you know, your great-grandfather met your great-grandmother, like, okay, we have enough money, we want to join it together, right? We shack up together. And then it's like,
There was no institution per se.
And then if it wasn't working, you go back home. Nobody sat with this judgment and a kolakala and laws and, oh my God, forget the laws, the judgment. And I think that's the issue. One of the reasons a single woman is also seen, this is another issue when you work in an office. You're single and over 30 means you're loose and looking for sex.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh my God, no. Maybe some people are, good for them. I'm here to do a job of work. So don't stereotype me. So this whole thing is, I think we need to come to that position where we need to take away this sexual depravity, this whole notion of what is virtuous. And a woman's honor is her sexual experience still. It's ridiculous.
Yes, it's ridiculous.
Not about, are you qualified, are
absolutely
you intelligent,
yes,
are you a person who's making waves in society, are you working for the people? It's more like, are you married?
Yes, and especially like in social circles when you go out and meet friends, your marital status seems to take precedence over everything else, especially when you're being introduced. So I had an experience where I, you know, we had a new boss coming in and all of us had to introduce ourselves. And, you know, the introduction was based on, hi, I'm so-and-so, I'm married, I have so many children, etc. So, and then it goes on, then here I am, okay. I'm so-and-so, I said I'm single and content. And everybody was like, some of them laughed, and they're like,
oh my God.
I'm like, that's my status,
yeah,
right? You know, I mean, if you want to hear my status, that's my status. And also when you know, meet people, when you go out, etc. Oh, here so-and-so here. Oh, you know, she's single. And I'm like... If you want to give me an introduction, please mention some of my accomplishments, please.
Yeah.
And how single do we point out to a married friend and say, oh, so-and-so, she's married.
Yeah.
Ooh, exactly. Married. How does that take precedence over everything else? I have so many other things that you might want
to... How do you deal with married friends who come to you with relationship advice? Who say marriage is wonderful, why don't you get married, can we introduce you? Forget the aunties.
So if it's our friends, actually some are genuine,
they will actually say
there is a guy who might be of your liking,
ilk,
and shall we arrange like a meetup, like drinks or something, and then whatever your comfort. I must say we are lucky that way
we have genuine friends who are like.
But I've also had a friend who once wanted to introduce me, this is many years ago, long time ago in Bethlehem, but she's like, there's a married guy and he's interested in you, and I'm like, I am not interested in married men. No, but he thinks you're hot. We'll meet for dinner. And I'm like, what the hell? Are you high? But then she has a shitty marriage.
I'm in that situation, which is why I'm asking. So you have reached a certain age and everyone of your age, almost everyone, 99% of them, are married, have families. So then you tend to also over time get a little isolated from those groups.
See, this is where it's important. Like I said earlier, if you make the choice to be where you are in life, it's very, very important you have a lot of things going on for yourself.
Yeah.
So that regardless of what kind of circle you are in, right, socially or within your friends or whichever function or wherever, you have something to talk about yourself. It's very, very, it might... See, it does not necessarily have to be about domestic issues, etc. But yes, those conversations will happen. But if you have enough things going on for yourself, your accomplishments, whatever you build for yourself, your career, your hobbies, your extracurricular activities, etc., there is no reason for you to feel insecure and left out at any point. I mean, if you know your current affairs, any point subject on politics or anything else opens up, you can always contribute. So there is absolutely, I have never felt like I'm being left out because, you know, because those conversations are going out and I don't have the same thing to talk about. There are so many instances where those girls or women don't have anything to contribute to a intellectual conversation. All they have is to talk about their maids' problems and husband's problems and children's problems, illnesses, etc. I'm not condemning them in any way. Those needs to be talked about. You need to talk about it with your friends. I'm saying you need to have the balance. Mm-hmm. So if you are, this is my stand. If you are choosing to be, if you're choosing singlehood and to be where you are in life, you also need to have things going on for yourself. Yeah. You need to have that independence. See, we need, as society, as people, we need to learn to respect another person's choice.
Yeah.
And singlehood is just one of it, right?
I just want to sort of wave the flag for women who might not want to have children.
Yeah, yeah. Fair enough. Of course. Possible. Fair enough. Yeah.
It doesn't make you some anomaly.
No.
It's just that, for instance, now I've never lactated at the sight of a child. I might lactate at the sight of a puppy or a kitten. That does not make me an absolute monster. Unfortunately, people do kind of put that on you. Oh, you're not human. You're not a woman. You know, like you have no femininity about you if you don't like kids. And I've had this even from men, right? Like, why don't you have kids? It's like, you know, not completely woman enough. If you know you're not gagging for the babies.
Yeah. But also this whole idea that a woman equates a mother is a problem. And this is a very South Asian space, I would say. Even India has this. This whole thing of where the fulfillment of a woman, the culmination of a woman's attainment in life is when she finally has a baby. Never mind if she had postpartum depression and that triggered, like, say, a lifelong of mental illness. Yeah. Never mind if she did not want this baby. Maybe she's miserable or it really put a huge strain on a relationship and the marriage is no longer what it used to be.
But it's a gift from God, and you do all these rituals around it.
Embrace it. And, yeah.
And they're not raising your baby with you.
No. They're not coming when you're up in the night tearing your hair because your kid won't sleep because they're screaming and you don't know what's wrong. Because
but you've become a mother and therefore
you're complete.
Stamped and then...
And then you belong to the motherhood tribe and you should be proud of yourself.
Anything beyond that is just like nobody's business. There's no one really out there to help her. And God knows if she's getting, you know, the kind of support that she needs from her partner. All of that is not considered at all.
And also, like, most men don't know how to handle a woman with a baby. They don't know babies.
That's where I want to go about men. Right? Okay. I want to talk about men's response to a woman who is single in Sri Lanka. Now, we know that at a young age, in your like late teens and your early adulthood and all that, it's all this one big love fest, right? They're looking for all the single girls and
hormones
all that.
Up.
But then again, the older you get, I feel like that concept or that perception of what a woman is also changes, a single woman, right? When she's young, she's expected to be single.
Yeah.
But when she's older, suddenly the way men look at you, if you're a divorcee or if you're single by choice, there seems to be some kind of like, I'm gagging for it. Kind of.
Oh, she's asking.
I'm holding up a sign.
She's desperate.
My head.
Yeah, it's written on your forehead. You're looking.
I'm here to sleep with all the boys.
Come, I need sex. Come
I'm
get
Marilyn
me.
Monroe.
No, and also that you get in offices. Actually, I noticed it especially because if you're over 30 and single, it's the idea. Machang, she just wants a fuck. Machang, she's looking for it, kind of thing. And you're like, no, sunshine, no. There might be women like that. Good for you. Find her. Don't come my way. I'm not looking for it. There is no sign here saying, you know, come fuck me or something. But that seems to be the idea because, again, that's what they've grown up with. They've grown up in a household where the ideology is that a respectable girl gets married at some point. And if you're single, you're subverting the social structure. Therefore, either you're loose or something's wrong with
something's wrong with you.
Something's missing in you. And then this whole idea of, like, again, Ane power so comes in. Machang, she missed the bus, no?
No,
I've of course learned to just let things go.
No, we are viragos now. Yeah. We've also got the label of the woman that scares the man in the office. So I once got this thing from a colleague who said, "Here, listen, all the guys are scared of you." So I'm like,
Yeah, I find you very
good. I think
yeah.
I've actually achieved that now. Again, okay. Also because I put on the whole prude part a lot. And okay. Like so much so that in office spaces, I'll be called mother superior.
Oh my gosh.
My grandmother would be very proud of me. Right? But when I hit 40, I had a bit of a midlife crisis. And I decided, no, you know what? I'm going to just meet new people. So okay. I'm not going to sleep with new people. But of course, immediately the assumption is, she's sleeping with him. But I have met people and I found that, okay, when you're older, when you're single, I've actually been relieved that I've been single because I've met mature men who I can sit and have a conversation with
yes, exactly.
And who have no expectation of like the minute they see you, they're like, oh, let's get into bed.
Yeah.
And they've become friends. Yeah. They've become friends. There's not been
you actually share a good companionship.
Yeah. It's not been about wild hormones and exactly. soy hormones. Yeah. And I felt relieved that I have not been in a marriage or something that has stopped me from
meeting those people.
That
there are people like that.
Men.
Absolutely.
No, that is true.
Responsible, stable, mature
true.
Men.
And they enrich your life. Those friendships actually enrich your life, your thinking, your personal growth, all of that.
Yeah.
No.
Which, which you would have missed out on. Yeah.
I know that I also have developed this identity, whether it's involuntary, of being intimidating. Like you said, man hater because feminist.
No, and also you're very aggressive and opinion. I said that's not my problem.
Yeah, you have an opinion.
Yeah, and it's like not
opinion,
my issue that you can't handle it. I don't come and tell a man you're overly opinionated and bossy
no
or
one,
something.
No one actually accuses a man of being opinionated.
Or aggressive.
Or
and
aggressive,
many men are
right?
very
exactly.
aggressive in the workspace. Yeah. In the sense that is
their
the
way of their way of winning arguments would be to raise their voice, etc.
But do you find yourselves being dismissed because you're single? Because you're not, you're not conforming to that boxed norm of a woman.
Dismissed in the sense?
By men.
They assume we don't know responsibilities. So their thing is, another thing.
Yes,
so you're not married, so you don't know what responsibility. You're like, sunshine, come live my life.
Yeah, live
I'll show
your
you
life
what responsibilities
alone,
are.
Live alone. And
yeah, just because you don't have kids and a spouse doesn't mean your responsibility ceases. I wish it did. Wonderful. Then we'll all just be with our legs up. But yeah, we take care of household things. We run our households. We cook.
There
cooking.
Is no one to run errands.
Run errands.
For,
and there's
right?
no one, honey, darling. Can I forget the garlic? Can you bring it and come?
Yeah.
You know, I'm making
you forget
something.
Forget the garlic. You have
to
go
out
and get it yourself.
You know,
right?
Get it yourself. And then even in office, it's like, you can work no late. You don't have anything to do. No, I cook for myself.
I have a life
outside this office. But no, you don't have responsibilities. No? And then it's like if you're single and if your siblings are married, you're the one in charge of your parents. Your elderly parents land on your head. Right? And of course, I must say my parents have never put it on me to say, listen, you have to look after us. We looked after you. It has never come for that. But I have a conscience, you know, I'm not going to be like, won't red duck happen to you and I'll be with my legs up sunning my bum somewhere. No, I can't. They are my responsibility and I genuinely love my parents. I want them to be okay. So I am now handling all that plus my own life things. I want to do things in my life. I'm studying, I'm doing other hobbies.
And you're
I
both
have...
climbing mountains to
get yeah.
of course,
of
we
course.
Do a lot of things for ourselves. Yeah. So it's very unfair. The assumption that just because you are single or not married, so you don't have the same responsibilities
as
people who are married
person
or a parent does not mean that we are jobless. That, you know, we have so much going on in our, we have things that we do for ourselves and it's important that you do, right? In offices, they might like, okay, working on a weekend, you can come over a weekend, you have nothing to do. No, I have a life to live. I have my extracurricular activities, you know, I have my hobbies, I have a household to take care of, I have to do cooking, cleaning, or mopping, or everything, anything else that requires, you know, I have to
what
do my own
traveling?
Laundry.
What about traveling and having fun as a single woman without necessarily needing to go on a date? Maybe you don't necessarily need to have your girlfriends around you. Just going out alone. Why is that? Like, I mean, how do you all feel? Because I love me dates. I call it me dates. I talk about it on social media. And a lot of my social media following is like, oh my God, you're so brave. Why? Because I went to the cinema alone.
Plenty of times I've watched movies on my own.
Or I went to a restaurant and had
my mother used to do that, so I'm okay doing
plenty
it.
And
then
I get DMs from people saying, did you go alone? Why is that a thing? And traveling. I love
traveling. On your own.
I love getting into the car. Yeah. If I could get into a bus, I would. But I have my own personal issues with buses. But I'd get onto a van or a train or whatever and go somewhere. And somehow, why is that like marriage brother, co-husband? It's like, and you're traveling alone, suddenly even places that you want to stay at, you're feeling a little intimidated by, because you don't know who's going to.
And also,
and the word that a single woman is staying here alone, and you never know, it's not safe.
It's unfortunately, not safe.
Practically, the fact that it's not safe is actually scary, and it's sad.
It is.
It's really sad.
And I think in Sri Lanka, I've traveled the world alone, and I love it. My mother can't
fathom it.
She can't be comfortable with it. I went to Europe for like a month and a half, and I don't think she slept for that entire month and a half. Like every 5 minutes, there was a FaceTime call to make sure that I was alive. And it was the most liberating thing to go to a country where this is a normalcy. Mm. That me having a backpack and walking around and, you know, exploring was not this anomaly like, oh my God. But here in Sri Lanka, if I want to travel, and I do, I like to go into the jungles. I like to go into communities. I like to go and like walk around. I don't want to stay cooped up in a hotel room where I feel safe. I want to explore. That's the whole fun of traveling. But why is it that single women have such an issue here?
Yeah, no, because of the...
Practically, it's not safe.
Practically, probably. And also patriarchy determines like, why are you out alone?
Yeah.
Like, isn't that either anything? Something happened, you're running away, or that you are out on a mission, you're meeting somebody on that trail, you know, some boy that you want to have a little
with. Even if it's that case, so
what? Yes, exactly. So what? You know, I was talking to my uncle, who's in his mid-70s, and he was telling me how he had shacked up with some foreign bird in his time, which would have been in the 1960s or 70s. They had agreed to meet in Ratnapura to climb Siripad. And I'm like, of course, it's pre-social media. Nobody knows. Yeah. You know, he chaka-chaka-fying and laughing and telling me this story. And of course, he and this girl met up and slept somewhere. And of course, in the night, Sri Lankan people peeping over the door.
You're kidding me.
These three sets of eyes looking over. And I'm like, oh my God. So obviously in his time, hello, it was called the swinging 60s for a reason. So they had a good time. And of course, because he's a man, he never had an issue, right? My grandmother wouldn't have had the hissy fit she would have had if, say, my aunts had wanted to venture out and be hiking to Siripada on their own would have been sacrilege. But, you know, I mean, that foreign lady who came at that time and, you know, no cell phones or anything. You just agreed to meet via, like, a telephone call.
Yeah.
And people did things like that then, you know. But our society just doesn't comprehend. Like, even if you go in a bus alone, say, long distance, I mean, a lot of women do it. I have a bunch of classmates who are in my master's class who are from all over Sri Lanka, and they regularly take these buses alone. And they wouldn't go on a trip alone. They'd always have a male there because of the safety factor.
Accompanying them for safety factor.
Also, when you travel, institutions like visas for overseas travel, if you're a solo female traveler, the number of questions and interrogations.
Really? Oh my gosh.
I mean, just the fact that you're trying to go overseas.
A guy now who kept telling me, I went to him for 10 years, a very prominent man, I will not mention his name. He kept telling me, get married, have babies, get married, make plans. Every time, from the age of 17, I went to him, listening to get married to 27. Till one day when I asked him, why do I have this issue? He said, you women and your hormones constantly fluctuating unlike men. I'm like, what the fudge? I stopped going to him after this. Like, this bastard, I'm not ever going to him again. And dude, I'm paying you. Yeah. And
your mother's fluctuating hormones. You have, the reason you're
doctors dessert. Don't have any right
be
to
grateful.
Discriminate you based on
exactly.
your
exactly. And also then, when I had to go through this DNC, which is a procedure that's done under general anesthesia. And the anesthetist had just like given me, like I was about to be wheeled into the theater. And the nurse, and mind you, another leading maternity hospital in this country, the nurse was like, Mrs. No, I'm like, nah, miss. And this nurse is going on to the anesthetist. Luckily, that woman was like, nah, nah, oh, mukuti tandepa. Like, she dismissed her. But I'm thinking, your hospital staff. And that test is how I realized that I am at high risk for cancer, which is why I'm on medication. So I'm like, darling, if I were to stick to virtuous notions of what a woman should allow between her legs, for medical reasons, right? I might be the next cancer victim because I was following tradition and some notion of some virtue. Whereas this is a strictly medical procedure. There's nothing sexual about it, right? The doctor needed to do this, but even medical staff are like that. So then how do you expect the common man to be any better?
So as much as the emotional and the psychological factor, the side of this story is very, very important, I also believe that if you look at world around, right, singlehood among women is a growing phenomenon. More and more women are choosing to either delay marriage or choose not to be married. The more job opportunities open up, more opportunities for education, attainment, etc., open up, thinking changes, more and more women are choosing. So this segment of society is kind of, it's expanding, it's increasing, right? So if you also look at it, this is the workforce in a country that is in their prime, right? Active, economically active workforce. If the society continues to routinely condemn them or harass them and stress them out for making that life choice, that is eventually going to impact the productivity.
Yeah.
And that's going to hurt the economy.
Yeah.
Right? So think about it in that sense. So it's very important that
if her life choices are
absolutely
not your priority,
exactly.
Think of the economy, prosperity, progress,
all of that,
yeah.
Socially, economically, all of that, right?
Yeah.
You wouldn't want to hamper with that.
Sure.
Right? So it's very important that we build a society which is safe and secure for single women, not just physically, also psychologically. Because at the end of the day, it's going to have an impact on the economy, their productivity, their output as citizens of a country.
Yeah.
So I'm not too sure if Sri Lanka has a formal body or to look into the concerns or the grievances, but I know for a fact that India has a forum for single women's rights, under which they have categorized and defined what a single woman is under four categories, etc. And then they have documentation, etc. Maybe India may not be the best example for this topic, but the fact that they have something like that in place is actually impressive.
Yeah.
So there is something, if you have a concern, there is something to go to,
yeah.
Right? So I think in that aspect, it's very important to make this a safe and secure society for single women who choose to be single or volunteer or by choice, volunteer or by circumstance, etc. So,
yeah, and you need to stop assigning blame also. That's another thing I think, see, even with like instances of rape or something, this notion of that she was a single woman out in an environment that is not conducive for women to be in, hence she got raped or she was abused or something, which is really ridiculous. She got raped because that man is a rapist.
Yeah.
It has nothing to do with her, where she was, what she was wearing, all that is
nothing
immaterial.
To do with her,
but when you're a single woman, like, see, I have been harassed by the police in my own house. And I know if there had been a man present that day when they came,
it would have been different.
They would not have harassed me the way they did. Because
they
knew it was a household of just two women living on their own. And that needs to stop. We need a society that stops laying blame on things for just being who you are. And you're not hurting anybody. Why would you sit and then say, and you're just like, no, stop normalizing.
Actually, that's a fact, Leela, because I have turned down invitations for dates when I've just said I'm not interested, thank you, and decline the invitation. That no is not accepted, right? The no is only acceptable if you say I have a boyfriend or I'm seeing someone. Suddenly that the presence of a man in your life is the only reason that you as a woman can have a choice to.
And also, marriage has also become, I'm not too sure, this may not be so common in urban, in urban Colombo, urban Sri Lanka, but marriage has also become your, for a girl, your only doorway to integration with community.
Mm-hmm.
You're not allowed to go on trips or to parties or go out in the night unless you are married. Exactly.
So while you're with me, I will guard
you
like the
don't, exactly. Parents don't bring up their daughter, their girl child to have her own life of her own before she starts sharing with somebody else.
Yes.
So from a younger age, you're being conditioned, you need someone else, you need someone else. So no wonder so many children out there, so many girls out there insecure. No wonder they're looking for validation. No wonder they're insecure and making wrong choices because of their insecurity, etc. And they become too vulnerable. So it's the mindset of the parents. I think the parents play a massive role.
Parents, teachers,
the education system, adults,
grandparents,
all of them play a massive role in instilling that confidence. That not to say, you know, you know your first choice should be to be single, but
Not to be foolhardy,
exactly.
But just be able to make that choice and be like, it's okay.
And if you have a daughter, this is like a sincere request, seriously. If you have a daughter who you see have had educational accomplishments, who's having a career going for herself, who is capable of taking care of herself, running a house, maintaining a vehicle, taking care of her things on her own, be proud of her. Don't be in a hurry to give her away, palm her off to anybody. Can you see that she's fine? And that she's choosing to be fine?
Yes.
Be proud of her and say, look, can you see my daughter? Oh, your daughter is married, 3-4 children are nice. Can you see my daughter? You know, she's this, she's studied this. So, you know, she's in this position in her company.
Exactly.
You know, she's making waves in society, like you said, right? And then she's just content at home and she's
taking
care of us.
Looking after the cactus.
She's doing great. She's doing great. She's happy. She's happy.
My daughter is happy should be what a parent should say. I am happy that my child is happy. It's not like I am happy because my child got married and popped a couple of kids. Or I'm happy because my child got married. Tick box done. My responsibility ends. But this is, I think, I don't know how many years it's going to take, but it needs people also to fight back.
Yeah.
We need to stop saying, like, for me, like, there are days I have said living as a woman in this country is such a curse. And it's such a tragedy to say that, because I love being a woman. I'm not going to change my sex to anything else. There are people who want to change. That's fine. I am happy being me. I'm not going to wish, I wish I was born a man. But there are days I wish I could just take my shirt off and walk on the down in my garden without some pervert hanging on the top there going, tandekak kind of thing. And, you know, like, get excited. And it's like, go check out your mama's boobs, sunshine. But, you know, there are days you just want, even wearing a pair of shorts. I mean, it's ridiculous, and especially when you're single, because if you have a husband, they're like, the husband allows her to dress like that, so we can't say anything. Whereas a single woman wearing, machang gal de kailien, sudu kakulen, bidi kakulen, ara kakulen, me engayen, you're like, no, I am not a license carte blanche for you to make comments on because I don't have a man next to me. That's not okay. You need to understand that, and that's basic human decency and respect. Those start at home. Yeah, and this is where parents need to have conversations with their kids, sons and daughters. Forget anything else. For women to have equality and respect, conversation has to start at home.
So, from Shush the Talk Show, this is one to all the aunties and uncles and the patriarchy out there. Checkmate.